Life isn't a matter of milestones, but of moments. Rose Kennedy. If I were a secret agent in the underground diaper brigade, the surest form of torture to make me sing like a canary would be whining. Just the pure, unadulterated, never-ending cacophony that is the sweet, dulcet tones of miserable, monstrous whining. It turns sweet children into horrible, unrecognizable creatures, and mothers into insane asylum patients. I'm not sure if this description adequately addresses my absolute loathing of whining. It reaches the point where I will my head to explode just so I can stop hearing it. The result would be blessed relief. Messy, but the pain would be gone. I have two daughters, and instead of running into walls, destroying each other and the house like marauding hordes of boys do, they employ effective emotional torture. They're masters at it. They don't even realize they're doing it. They're so good. One summer, we'd established a solid rhythm. I could anticipate when we needed some downtime or quiet time via a bit of genius television. The girls would watch Olivia, Charlie and Lola, Ni Hao Kai Lan, or any combination of all of them. Then school started. In the scorching heat of August. Something about starting school before Labor Day seems, if not illegal, then irrational. August is filled with temperatures in the 90s and 100s. By the end of the school day, my oldest, a second grader at the time, came home emotionally spent. She began to pick at her little sister who'd been waiting all day for her to come home and play. She clammed up when I asked her how her day was. She wailed about how awful her life was, now that she didn't have time to play, dance, sing, draw, and write. Instead, she had to go to school and be tired. I inspected her lunch during her tirade and discovered it was barely touched. With concern and a bit of exasperation, I asked her, "Why didn't you finish your lunch?" Which turned into wailing, "They don't give us enough time. It's awful. Lunch is so short." I asked her to sit down and finish her lunch, which only succeeded in her losing any semblance of rational thought. So I told her very calmly to go upstairs, visit the bathroom, undress into her pajamas, and take a nap. I told her that while she got into bed, I would turn on the air conditioning. She stomped up the entire 16-step staircase. I actually counted them on my way up just because I like to be exact when measuring just how moody my girls can be. My mind raced with what I could do to improve the situation. I hated seeing her like this. I hated that I hadn't found a way to help her through her moods. Somehow, as I was running around the house, closing the windows and turning on the air conditioning, it hit me. She just needed to be loved. The answer was so simple, so obvious, that I wanted to smack my head like Homer Simpson. I simply lay on the bed with her while the fans cooled the air, and in solidarity, we lay on her back. We cuddled. I scratched her back. After a while, she began to talk about her day. I listened. She shared. And I asked her questions, which she answered enthusiastically. I could feel my stress falling away, and I felt her regain her energy. We only lay there for about 30 minutes, but the effect was profound. Often our lives feel like a series of getting from appointment to appointment, add kids into the mix, and it can feel like we're spinning the wheels just because we feel the wheels must keep spinning. As a result, I sometimes get lost in the running and running some more. Who knew that loathsome whining would bring me to an epiphany? In that blessed, almost divine moment, I realized how powerful, simple silence is. and that being still would act as a salve to our souls. Do my girls still whine and have emotional outbursts? If they're anything like me, of course. However, practicing the simple act of time together and being still, we're able to connect in a more meaningful way as we help each other become human again. Postscript, Kalia and Malia, guess what? I love you.